Everyone, welcome to a conversation with David Briggs. My name is Dana Settles. I work in the development department and with our stewardship. So we are hosting this video for all of our lovely donors that are here. We're just going to wait a few minutes for everyone to come in and make a few housekeeping announcements, and then we'll be off.
Fantastic. Welcome, everyone. I'm Kent Tritle, the director of music at the Cathedral, and I just adore that we are doing this today.
And me too, David Briggs. I'm currently in Memphis, Tennessee, in between concerts in Cincinnati and Nashville. So nice to be in the deep south again.
Oh. We can probably chat a little bit before we get the go ahead and really, really begin informally. But David, how many concerts a year do you play?
About 65, somewhere around that. Yeah. Maybe about half in the US and half on the other side of the pond. Yeah.
That's so incredible. That's so incredible. And it's really everywhere. I mean, you're on all kinds of organs all the time. Ancient, modern.
Yeah. Variety is the spice of life. And I mean, I'm extremely fortunate. I absolutely love what I do. And I love the travel. And I love meeting new people, making new friendships, and maintaining those friendships. And I mean, from a musical point of view, these instruments, you know, especially the historic instruments, are such great teachers in their own way. So, you know, the instruments themselves really tell you a lot. Yeah.
Yes, they do.
How you're playing, yeah.
So I think we can get started. I'm going to make a few announcements, and then we can get going. In your conversation. So once again, my name is Dana Settles. I'm with the Development Department. We're so happy you're here today to talk about David Briggs' upcoming concert, which we'll get into a moment. Just letting you know, we are recording this video, and we will send it out to all of you tomorrow. We will also have it up on the Cathedral's YouTube channel. And so if you would not like to perhaps have your face, just in case, on our YouTube channel, you can make sure to stop your video. And then we are also, if you haven't already, muted yourself, and that will cut down on some background noise. And lastly, while David and Ken are talking, please add your questions to the chat. And then at the end of their conversation, we can ask the questions, and we'll leave about 15 minutes at the end for questions and any other questions that might pop up during our discussion of the questions. So I am so excited to welcome David Briggs and Kent Tritle here today. So take it away, fellas.
No, thank you,
Dana. Thank you, Dana. Thank you, Dana. Well, yes, I'm Kent Tritle, Director of Cathedral Music, and one of the great privileges, both in my life and I think in the life of the musical, the musical history of this cathedral, is that we have David Briggs as our artist in residence. Now, David is extraordinary. He's one of the top, tippy top concert artist organists in the world, and he is all over the world playing. And so to have him in residence at the cathedral is really, really, really very special. And David is a multifaceted, complete, total musician, and also one of the finest, nicest people you will ever meet in person. So we're delighted that you're here with us today to talk about what's upcoming. By the way, there are banners, gorgeous banners, on the cathedral fences, and tickets are selling to this concert that we have. David, I'm just thrilled that you've chosen to honor Pierre Cochereau. And I wonder if you might tell us about your long history with that incredible artist.
Yeah, thank you, Kent, and for those very kind words as well, which I very much appreciate. Actually, Cochereau and I never met in person, but I remember in August of 1980, I did hear him just once. We were on a family vacation from the UK, and we went to Paris for a weekend. And I'll never forget hearing him play the 11 o'clock mass. It was called Messe Grand Orgue, big organ mass. And I remember there were 2,000 people sitting there in the nave. And the dean of the cathedral after the mass said, "Go in peace to serve and love the Lord." And then he said, after the benediction, "Et maintenant, Organzorg Pierre Cochereau. He actually introduced Cochereau, who was going to play the sortie or the postlude. And I remember in the congregation, nobody moved. It was just an extraordinary thing. Such high voltage music and these incredible pyrotechnics. And I remember the end of the postlude, where it ended in this enormous sound of D major, a big cadence, and the sound of the applause sort of cross-faded with the sound of the tutti, the organ of Notre Dame. I'd never really come across anything like it. But my fascination with Cochereau goes actually back much further than 1980. It was when I was a choir boy at Birmingham Cathedral as a 10-year-old, and the assistant organist of the cathedral, a guy called John Pryor, he lent me this recording of Cochereau, which was then brand new, 1970.
David, which cathedral were you choir boy at, by the way?
Choir boy, Birmingham Cathedral in the UK.
Thank you.
Yeah, and there were 26 boy choristers and 18 men, and it was a fantastic choir. But the organist was a great disciple of French organ music and Marcel Dupré and Duroflé, and especially of Cochereau, and he lent me this recording, and I remember my dad saying to me as a 10-year-old little boy that he wondered whether my headphones were actually surgically attached to my head, because I just listened to it all the time. I could not stop listening to this extraordinary recording of Cochereau improvising on Alouette, Gentille Alouette. And this is one of the pieces actually that I'm going to be featuring in the concert on the 27th. But Cochereau was appointed in Notre Dame in 1955, and he stayed there until his premature death at the age of only 59 in 1984. He really loved to live life in the fast lane and always wanted the newest cars, the newest cameras, the newest hi-fi. He was actually on the first Air France Concorde from Charles de Gaulle to Kennedy in New York. And he really lived life at 200 kilometers per hour, you could say. And I think that Cochereau and Notre Dame in Paris were, the two names were virtually synonymous. I mean, he excelled, I think, really, especially in the huge ceremonies. He played for the funeral of Charles de Gaulle and President Pompidou, Claudel, the mass for John F. Kennedy, which was absolutely enormous. I think 20,000 people went to that mass in Paris in 1963. So he had a sort of almost like a rock star status, and his concerts were very famous, on free concerts on Sunday afternoons, and people were leaning against the pillars and sitting on the floor even. He was kind of a bit of a rock star, you could say. And for me, the finest organ in the world is Notre Dame, Paris. It was originally constructed, well, there are actually some wood parts in the case dating from the 15th century, but it was a lot of work was done in the 18th by Clicquot. It was a French classical organ. And then in 1868, it was completely rebuilt by the greatest organ builder of the 19th century in France, Aristide Cavaillé-Coll. And then when Cochereau was there in 1962, the organ was not in terribly good condition, and he made the decision to electrify the organ with an American-style console. In 1968, he added a set of very powerful chamard reeds. You can see them in that photo just at the bottom of the facade there. And it's quite a good story about these chamards, because the rumor has it that he actually paid for them himself and didn't ask the priests. Because he thought they probably wouldn't notice. But it makes a huge, as you'll hear in just a few minutes, an incredible addition to that wonderful instrument. So that view and the photo there is the view from the organ tribune. And of course, it's something of a miracle that building survived. They had a fire the day before ours. Theirs was much more cataclysmic, as we all know. And I mean, it came within, I think, about an hour of complete collapse of the whole building. But it's miracle. It's a complete miracle that nobody was killed. And also that the greatest organ in the world, in the opinion of many, including myself, survived that fire. And it's being put back exactly as it was, which is terrific. So Khosrow loved the United States, and he came here 35 times on tour. He was treated like a king here. And I think the thing that that really set him aside as doing something that really nobody else did to this standard was improvising. And he really had his own style. He didn't really like to compose that much because he was so busy. And I think he didn't really want to be considered as a second-rate Ravel or a second-rate Debussy, although that's the sort of style in which he improvised. But to my ear, he had a style that was really kind of unique. And I think had we now had computers and laptops and composition software, he would have probably enjoyed composing. So we might even have had orchestral symphonies and organ concertos, who knows. But I spent about 11 years transcribing a lot of his most famous improvisations from Notre Dame, but I'll speak about that a little bit more in a moment. And each time that Maj, my wife and I go to Paris every January, we've been there every January for 20 years now since we've been married, always the same hotel, apart from, for obvious reasons, during COVID. But I like to go to Belleville and tend his grave, and there it is. That's with the, he died at the very, very early age of just 59. And as I mentioned, really lived life in the fast lane. Huge smoker. He liked his Johnny Walker Red whiskey. And unfortunately, a lot of stress in his life. And one of the things actually was the decline of the organ in Notre Dame, which went downhill quite substantially at the end of his time. And I remember the first time I played there, which was in December 1985, just the year after Pierre died, the organ was in a terrible condition, and only two of the combination pistons worked. That was the full organ, the tutti piston and the cancel, and the general crescendo piston worked, but there was a marvelous guy there operating all the stops. So, but nevertheless, it was one of those kind of amazing epiphany moments of playing in Notre Dame for the first time. So that's his grave at Belleville. On the next photo, I think this is quite an unusual photograph. I mean, we all know and love the picture of the facade of Notre Dame in Paris, taken from the other side. But that's actually from a picture that I took in 2015 from the central spire, which of course burnt and collapsed and brought half of the nave down with it on the 19th of April. In 2019, but I was able to get that photograph through a good friend of mine who's been the architect of the cathedral for 30 years, Philippe Villeneuve, and he's done this absolutely extraordinary job of recreating the cathedral. And I was just in Paris 5 weeks ago, and the way that the building is being restored exactly as it was, even with the 1,000-year-old wood in the vaulting, is absolutely incredible. But anyway, that's the view from the central spire. The West Tower is dating from the 12th century, and a great view. I always think it looks a little bit like a doggy, that picture with the nose. So Villeneuve, yeah. This next photograph, I think that's Pierre Khosrow, age 6. I love that picture because it sort of sums up his determination. He was an only child, very wealthy upbringing. His father owned 15 shoe factories. He was definitely a child prodigy. He actually studied with Marguerite Long, who was a great friend of Maurice Ravel, got a very good piano technique. Except there was one problem with Khosrow's lessons with Marguerite Long. It only lasted about a year, that relationship, because whenever she was trying to tell him something about what to do with his fingers, how to learn his technique, he apparently would be listening, but he'd also be improvising on the piano at the same time. And she got rather frustrated by that. But when you listen to Khosrow playing, you can tell that he had really the keyboard technique of a concert pianist, and also could use his feet, of course. So that's Khosrow, age 6. This next photograph, I always find really quite shocking. Would you believe in that photograph, he was 59 years old. It was taken in February 1984, just about you know, about 3 weeks. He died on the 4th of March, 1984, of a cerebral hemorrhage. But I think probably more than anybody that I've ever known, sort of aged prematurely. This next photograph actually was taken three days before his death. That was on the Sunday, the 2nd of March, I think it was, in 1984. And he the last thing he did was to improvise a set of meditations on the whole of St. Matthew's Gospel over a period of about, I think, 6 weeks. He did this on the Sunday, and then he died on the Monday night in Lyon. But so there he is, age 59, but again, a wonderful generosity of spirit and passion for the organ, for his instrument in Notre Dame, which he loves so much. Here's another little view of his grave in Belleville. And I think after that, two more views from the Organ Tribune. I do remember that view, seeing that for the first time in 1984. Because if you play a concert there, you get two rehearsals. They are lasting about 3 hours each, on the Friday night and the Saturday night. And that view when you're playing, and that's the view from the organ console. There's nothing else quite like it in the world. It's so incredibly inspiring. So he was born 100 years ago in July in 1924. And I'm really so happy to be given this opportunity to introduce some of his amazing improvisations to my friends in New York, and grateful indeed for this opportunity. That's the west front of the cathedral a few evenings ago. And of course, we'll be using the organ that we're using in the cathedral at the moment, the Walker Technical Company organ, which we've been using since Easter Day of 2019, after the little fire that we had in the basement. And I mean, I would say about this organ, I mean, normally I don't enjoy digital organs so much. But this is kind of the exception. It's the only digital organ I've ever fallen in love with. It sounds absolutely amazing, I think, in the acoustic of St. John the Divine. And I mean, I would say one of the great joys and privileges that I have about being associated with the cathedral is the opportunity not only to perform concerts in the building, but also to have regular access to this extraordinary cathedral, which I've really come to love so much. And the acoustic of the cathedral, of course, is one of the really great things, I think, which helps the sound of the Walker organ very much. So what I thought, I have actually prepared three short videos, 5 minutes or so each. And the first one I've put together is on the first beat of the concert. It's a piece called Variation sur Alouette, Gentille Alouette, which is a famous French folk tune. And this is the first piece by Kosher that I ever transcribed from recording back in 1989. And I thought it'd be interesting to just put on the video two versions. First of all, the original. It's a theme on the great plongeur. You can hear the chamard reeds in this first variation that I spoke about, the horizontal trumpets. It's an amazing blaze of sound. And then the second piece, it's a short variation called fileuse, which is French for spinning wheel. So here's the video. That's
David, before we
transcribe. Yeah.
I'm sorry, before we go into the video. Folks, I just want to share what I think is really an astonishing thing here. So we may be aware of like the jazz greats who played and were only captured, you know, in an album and never in written music. And it was always astonishing to me, the individuals who had the technology and also understood in terms of their ear and their technique, what it was that those great artists were doing. and then somehow figure it out to transcribe or perform that performance. And David, can you just talk just a little bit? Transcribing means David has a recording and you're capturing something that is not a music at all, that is infinitely complex. Mm-hmm. So can you just say something about transcribing and something about maybe how long it took to transcribe Alouette? And then we should...
Here's what I looked like when I was doing the transcription.
Yes.
So essentially, I mean, you have the original recording and then obviously you listen to it and fall in love with it. And then when you actually write it out, you just listen to each bar, each measure. Sometimes, maybe 20 times, you listen to the top part. You work out, first of all, what the chronology is, whether you're in 4-time, 3-time, 2-time. So you map it out like you would a roadmap, and you listen to the top part. And then the second thing is you get the bass played by the feet. That's usually fairly easy. And then it just becomes a bit like a kind of musical Sudoku in a way, working out what on earth he's doing in the middle of the texture. And I mean, I did work out once to do this takes an average of about 4 hours to transcribe 1 minute of music. So, I mean, it's just time. And you're listening to this to one bar maybe 30, 40, 50 times. But I'm fairly methodical and strict. I mean, unless I can really hear a note, I don't write it down. So essentially it's kind of play, pause, rewind, write down 3 or 4 notes, play, pause, write down another 3 or 4 notes. Mm-hmm. But that's all it is. And now it's a little bit easier because with the very fast, the piece I'm just going to play at the moment, you'll hear the feelers, the spinning wheel, is incredibly fast. And so, you know, it's, and when I say fast, the right hand is, so in the old days, the recording 1 octave lower, but of course it's half speed. So that gives you a chance of hearing the pitches. Now with the computer software, you can actually play it slower and keep the same pitch. So there's kind of no excuse, but that's the long and short about the method of transcription. Yeah.
A fair amount of genius in all of that. Let's hear your clips. That's great. Thank you.
So that's amazing. That's a few notes there.
It's incredible. Incredible. Well, now do we have yet? We can go on with our conversation now, I believe.
You're good.
Fantastic. You're good. So, of course, you know, I feel like you're an artist that just kind of dropped down from the heavens. But David, how did you get into music? Was your family musical? You know, was it a particular teacher? What happened that brought you to where you are?
Well, gosh, who's that little chap there? Oh, my goodness. Well, that's me aged about, I don't know, a few months. But my mum says that one of the first musical things I did was sing the Vidor Toccata in the shopping cart going around the supermarket in Birmingham, England, much to the bemusement of the other shoppers. But my parents were both musical, and they actually met in the orchestra. They met in an orchestra in Birmingham. My mum was a violinist, and my dad was an engineer by profession, but he was a really very gifted cellist as well. In fact, the last 5 years of his life, he passed away in 1979, but for the last 5 years, he made a cello using a pantograph and copying an old German cello. But I used to accompany him a lot, playing Brahms sonatas and Beethoven sonatas, the Shostakovich. And so music was very much around me growing up, but I never... it was never like forced or anything like that. It was just, we listened to a lot of LPs and short playing records. And we used to go to the Birmingham Orchestra a lot. My parents used to take me to that. So, and actually my granddad was quite a well-known organist. He was the organist of St. Jude's Church in Birmingham for 41 years, where they used to do orchestral masses. He was actually very famous as an improviser. And some of my earliest memories of sitting on the organ bench next to my granddad and marveling at this amazing sound, all the stops and all the swirl pedals. But I always used to note, as I have perfect pitch, and that when he improvised after the service, the last chord was always either D major, E flat major, or A flat major. And I worked out why that was afterwards, because those were the only three notes that worked on the 16-foot trombone on the pedal. So he always ended in that key, which was rather neat. So I used to go to music courses in nearby Warwick. I think that's probably about nine there, doing a little bit of conducting the trumpets and the cellos. I used to actually, I played the violin as well from when I was about 9 or 10. You have to admit my dress sense is really rather good. That great 1970s flowery shirt there. It's so funny the way that things come back into fashion. But I always like to be a trendsetter for fashion, of course.
great taste.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, so that's a little bit of the violin. And then actually, when I was 13, I was involved in a piano competition in Birmingham. On the BBC, actually, it was on the television, and I remember for that one of the tests was, as well as playing Bach and some Debussy, we had to improvise to a silent film, and I remember it was something about sheep running around in a field and something about a hot air balloon. But I've always enjoyed improvising to visual stimulus as well. And then from 1970 until 73, I was a choir boy here at Birmingham Cathedral, which is a marvelous Baroque building with the architect Thomas Archer. And there were, as I mentioned, 26 boy choristers and 18 men. It was a fantastic choir. We did a lot on the radio. And I used to sit third along on cantores. And in 3 years, I just had one solo because my voice was never that good. But I did have perfect pitch, so the choir master Roy Massey put me in the middle of the side, so at least I could come in on the right note each time. But that was a marvelous experience being there, and it's really where I fell in love with the sound of the organ. And I used to get told off a lot for turning round and looking to see whether the assistant organist had pulled out the pedal trombone at the end of the last verse and of the hymn. So that was a very, very formative time, 3 years, I think. And then when I was about 13, 12 or 30, and I managed to get a music scholarship to a school just about 10 miles to the southeast of Birmingham, a place called Surly Hull. They had a wonderful chapel there. I think there's a photograph of the chapel with an amazing organ teacher. This guy called Colin Edmondson. He was only 23 years old. He was a music scholar from Oxford, very fresh, and he was wonderful at teaching organ and also harmony and counterpoint. So a very, very sort of strict, but compassionate at the same time. Time at Surly Hull, and I think that in 5 years there were four of us who obtained the fellowship diploma of the Royal College of Organists. And just occasionally I go back and practice there and do a few masterclasses, and it's always lovely to go back to Surly Hull, where I sort of grew up. And there's a picture of the organ there. And then after Surly Hull, I was very fortunate. Actually, this is just before going on to Cambridge. This is a church in Birmingham called St. Albans on Conybeare Street. It's in a inner city zone in the centre of Birmingham, but a wonderful church by John Loughborough Pearson, one of the finest Victorian architects to come out of the 19th century in England. And I was organist there for 2 years. And it was a great training ground because it's very, very Anglo-Catholic. You can see there a lovely acoustic, as you can imagine, with that stone vault, about a 5 second acoustic. And they used to use so much incense that you could hardly see the vault, almost as much incense as St. John the Divine, in fact. So playing for the liturgies there, and a lot of improvising and a lot of very precise moments when you had to comment on the scripture or the liturgical movement and stop very precisely at a given moment. And in those days, I had quite a bit of hair, as you can see. That's just in about 1981, which was the year that I went on to Cambridge University. I think it's very privileged to be the organ scholar of King's College for 3 years, probably one of the very finest and most beautiful sacred buildings on the planet. Dreamt up by King Henry the VI, and actually the organ screen there you can see was Venetian, and for a few years there was no organ on top of it, and then in about 1606 they built the organ, and that's the view from the quadrangle. That was a marvelous time being there, and you've probably heard of the very famous carol service that is broadcast every Christmas Eve to an audience of 35 million people. But actually for me, the very amazing thing about being an organ scholar there actually was that an evensong on a Thursday in the middle of February was equally as important as playing for an audience of 35 million. So it was a great training ground that everything had to be pretty much right, you know, with the right notes and exactly with the choir and with the right balance and everything every day, and not just for the big occasions. Some of the most spectacular medieval stained glass anywhere in the world. And it's marvelous to hear the choir continuing in absolutely supreme form. That photograph there, you can just see me under the umbrella on the right, but a lot of these guys who were choral scholars at my time have gone on to be very, very famous singers. Most notably, I suppose, Gerald Finley, who's the second from the left, who he and I were contemporaries, and he's now one of the greatest, of course, baritones on the opera scene, singing all over the world. And then my first job was at Hereford Cathedral, just in the Welsh borders. Beautiful, again, very ancient cathedral. And a wonderful boys choir there, and a superb organ by Father Henry Willis from 1892. So I got to really love that instrument, and playing evensong 6 days a week. So a lot of notes to learn, particularly in the first year of a job. And that's where I lived, on the top floor of that house in the cathedral close, which was really a lovely experience. and just outside the house. So the guy in the background there is actually Sir Edward Elgar, who was a very frequent visitor to the Three Choirs Festival. And he loved Hereford Cathedral. And actually, when I went there in 80, oh yeah, that's me imitating Elgar. In 1985, when I first went to Hereford and played for the Three Choirs, there were still six people in the festival chorus who'd sung under Elgar in 1933 in a performance of the Dream of Gerontius. And that is the organ loft, the Willis console. And sometime after I left, they decided it would be a good idea to have a big mirror on the wall behind. So now you can watch your wrong notes twice. So very nice. But a marvelous organ, last rebuilt in 1978, and then again in about 2002, I think.
And hi, I just want to mention that it is 12:40. And so.
Oh, we need to move on.
Yes. Yeah. We have a few questions. So just letting you know.
I'll speed up. So this is in Paris when I went to study with Jean Langlais at Saint Clotilde, the great Cavaillon organ there. Studied with him, a great blind organist and a fantastic teacher. That was very inspiring. I used to go over from England on the hovercraft and spend a weekend in Paris for 12 lessons. A very, very formative experience. A lot of improvising. St. Clotilde. And then that's Truro Cathedral in the UK. That's when I first actually became in charge of the music in 1989. Beautiful building, again by Pearson, built in 1890 to finish in 1920. Glorious West Towers there. And that was in about 1990. The Father Willis organ. And there was the Cathedral Choir, boys choir, very nice group, including a remarkable, the little chap, let me think, fifth from the right, Olaf Schmidt, who became a bomb disposal officer in Afghanistan and lost his life doing that about 15 years after being a chorister. But he was a marvelous head boy at Truro. You know, there's a scholarship in his memory. And then in 1995 to Gloucester Cathedral, that's probably the finest medieval tower in the UK, absolutely glorious from the 14th century. And the organ case on the screen, as you can see, dating from the very early 17th century, about 1606. An evensong every day of the week, apart from Wednesdays. And that is the great choir of Gloucester Cathedral, which was, as you can see, in the perpendicular style, the tomb of Edward II was at Gloucester. And they had so many pilgrims that they raised the roof. This was in the 1400s. Absolutely incredible. And a glorious 9-second acoustic in there. And then in 2003, we came to the US, and in 2000, first of all to New York, but then in 2006, moved to Ipswich, Massachusetts, and that was my home organ in Ipswich. Beautiful organ by Fisk from the 1980s. So that was a great organ to practice on, and as you can see, a beautiful church, a wooden church, actually by Renwick, who was the same architect as the National Cathedral in Washington, Ipswich, on the North Shore, about 28 miles north of Boston. And then 5 years in Toronto, that's the very famous CN Tower. And I was the artist in residence for 5 years at the Cathedral of St. James, the Episcopal Cathedral in the center of Toronto. There's the organ on both sides. A very nice professional choir there. And a lot of accompanying, a lot of improvising, a lot of practicing, a lot of composing. And then you recognize that, the wonderful, our West, glorious West Front. And so it's amazing that now starting the seventh year in New York. And I would say that this is by far my happiest job of my career. It's I absolutely love being based here. I love what the cathedral stands for, love the building, but most of all, love the people. It's such a wonderful atmosphere, wonderful choir, and really great honor to collaborate with the music team here. So composition, just recently, last year actually made a new CD at Saint Eustache in Paris with the wonderful choir of Trinity College, Cambridge. And that's a picture of the recording, which is just out about 4 weeks ago. The great organ of Saint Eustache. Unfortunately, when we made the recording, it was over 100 degrees outside. So one of the tenors fainted during the sessions. It was unbearably hot. And that's the Hyperion recording studio for this recent CD from the recording guys. So my friend Stephen Layton, who is the director of music at Trinity College, Cambridge, who spearheaded this project. And the great organ of Saint Eustache, five manuals, and they're also actually just about to restore the organ in Paris. And I think we have just a little clip of the of that recording. It's a setting of Set Me as a Seal, quite a short piece.
Beautiful, beautiful. so extraordinarily beautiful.
Thank you, Ken.
Yes.
When it's sung like that, it is.
Absolutely. And that
is one of the finest choirs in the world, without any doubt, I think.
Fantastic. He's amazing. And also, you know, we're so fortunate to do your music also in our liturgical programming. We were Stabat Mater last year. I know we have questions, but yeah. I'm going to leave with a question. Is it true that Monsieur Cochereau used to helicopter between Notre Dame and his home?
No. He drove in his Citroën CX Prestige, very fast sports car, or took the TGV. Yeah, people say he was a private pilot. He was never a pilot. He loved
aviation.
And he was always on planes, but he never actually flew himself. No.
Urban legend. And the other thing is that I don't know if you're aware, you may know John Grady was long time at St. Patrick's and was a dear friend.
I do. And he was with him actually 36 hours before he died.
Mm.
John was playing the recital, I think, on that Sunday at the beginning of March. There's a photograph of the two of them. That was the last time Pierre played. Yeah. And actually, one of the pieces I'm going to play, the last piece of the concert, is his last ever improvisation. And it's called Mission Universelle, Eternal Mission. And it's the last movement of this cycle of improvisations on the St. Matthew Gospel. And he, throughout this cycle, he had this rising theme called the Jesus theme. So it begins with this, and then has this enormous crescendo, this extraordinary buildup, and then finishes with the Bach Passion Chorale on the tutti, on the full organ. And that's the last thing he ever played. It's kind of, I think he probably knew that he didn't have long left. You know, I think he probably, it's a little bit of a premonition. Yeah.
So that's amazing.
Seeking eternal salvation in the music of Bach, I think.
Yeah. Wow. Dana.
Yes, we have a few questions here that I'd love to read out. Eric Brock says, can you describe the differences you experience playing the pneumatic, electronic, and digital consoles, and what is gained and lost with each?
Oh, my goodness. Well, for the player, I mean, you know, the digital has been great. I mean, it's the action is very prompt, and it's a very nice organ to practice on. I think the sound is, I mean, it's one of the best electronics you can buy, but there's still, I think, quite a big chasm between the reality and, you know, and the imitation. I mean, it's very impressive, but it's not the real thing. I think it's perhaps the difference between a Steinway Model D and a high-end electric piano. You know, it's so for me, the real instrument is always better, I think, in terms of just the reality and the resonance of the sound.
Okay, cool. Thank you. And then Eric also asked, in classical music, improvisation, it seems uniquely the providence of the organist. Why has that legacy continued past the period when music was in support of religious service and its hymns?
Great answer. I mean, I think historically, improvising has always been a very important part of Western music until about 1900. And then for whatever reason, it declined. And of course, the jazzmen then kind of took over. But it's very encouraging, I think, now to see that people are taking improvising more seriously. It's being taught much more uniformly, I think, in conservatories. And not just for organists as well. You know, in the old days, in the Baroque or in the classical period, the great composers were also very renowned as improvisers: Mozart, Handel, Bach, Chopin, Liszt. They were all renowned improvisers. So, I mean, for me, improvising is real music making because it's really of the moment, and you're not recreating somebody else's thought pattern in a way. It's really kind of you, for better or for worse.
Yeah, it's really interesting. Okay, and the other question is from Andy Cavatorta. Do you ever imagine or desire more textures of sound or timbres that are found in typical stops?
Well, one of the things I love to do is really explore every nook and cranny of an instrument. And I think improvising is one way where you can really do that a lot. But and I think, you know, there are two ways that organists can sound different to each other. First of all, is very importantly with the touch, but also the type of registration that we use, the combination of stops. It's a little bit like what Cochereau used to say, on fait de la cuisine. You're doing cookery when you're preparing a recital and preparing your sounds that you have. So I like to make it absolutely as varied as possible, as almost like an orchestral concert in a way. It's a kind of similar palette of color.
Thank you so much. Does anybody have any last questions or ideas maybe that they'd like to put to David or Ken?
David, could you just share what you're looking forward to perhaps most in the upcoming program on the 27th?
Yes. Well, I mean, I've spent quite a while what we call registering or setting up the combinations of stops for this concert of Cochereau. I think what I would say is there's a huge variety of different music, and it's his style is so, I mean, electrifying, and it's full of brilliance, full of emotion. So I suppose just to kind of, in a way, communicate the wonder of these improvisations to the contemporary audience is what I'm really most looking forward to. And acting as an ambassador for Cochereau. Yeah.
I'm so glad we had this time, David. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Yeah, thank you to everyone that was able to attend. We're going to send you the recording of this lovely talk, and we hope that you can attend David's concert next week. And then there's other concerts that the Cathedral proper will be holding. So please check our calendar online. And we hope to see you really soon. Okay, thanks everyone.
Thank you all. Thank you, development folks. Thank you guys. Great. Sure.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.